Welcome. Welcome. I'm still a little bit COVID ridden, but there we go. So Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom is just one cue from this, and it's 1M6 and 1M6A. So this is the Once in a Vial, the Barroom Brawl sequence, and 1M6A, there we go. It is ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous. There are two scores which need to be superimposed on each other. So we'll deal with the first one first, which is the actual orchestral music. it's extremely hard to decipher from the handwriting, and took many, many, many days, actually not hours, many days to sort of decipher it all. And there were numerous errors and problems, and also two pages missing as well, which had to be reconstructed orally. Which I think I've done reasonably okay, right at the end, where you've got the anything goes as well, which is sort of all of this bit here. So from here. Cuts back in again, thank God. That was a nightmare. I think that took me a day just to do that. Yes, that's kind of ridiculous. Also, Note Performer is truly dreadful, really, when it comes to this sort of stuff. It just doesn't have anything like the sort of authenticity that you really need. But also, imagine trying to program that would take you considerably longer. Although, there are people who have hit a bit of a holy grail with that, so more news on that later, especially if you follow VI control. There's a whole sort of thread about it. So that's the orchestra one, and then we've also got this dance orchestra. So unusually, soprano sax, two altos, one tenor, Of course, it would normally be two altos, two tenors, Barry. So it's interesting that there's nothing like that. We got three trumpets, not four, and then we got three trombones, not four as well. So it's a dance orchestra. It's not a full big band. Then we got upright bass, a kit, also piano, but I can't really hear it, so I just left it out. So it's almost entirely improvised, I would have thought. Pardon me. And that in itself is just a whole sort of work of art as well, because of course all the sort of various voice leaning bits. So what I did was I produced that as well, I'll supply this as a sheet to everybody, because it's just a bit too small to see on YouTube, so, and it really requires a huge amount of study. What's really intriguing is that at the same time that the dance orchestra is going along, the rest of the orchestra also play. The only recording I could find of this, and somebody might be able to point me in the right direction, was a slightly almost like mono sound of the dance orchestra with the rest of the orchestra. You can sort of hear the violins in the background, but it sounds very dated, unless it was a sort of deliberate sort of production ploy. But of course, there's lots of sound effects going on at the same time anyway, so it's actually very difficult to sort of make out. However, you know, in terms of the actual notes, I've managed to superimpose it, and in the score, the orchestral score, it says dance, you know, starts here at that bar 38, and then it cuts out a bit later on at, whoops, that's a bit silly, isn't it, where is it, sort of a little bit later on there. So what's that, 67? So it does go on for quite a while, and of course there's so much going on. So, you know, it's the fact that he's done two pieces of music, but they all coincide with each other, but not on the same score, which I just can't get my head around. I suppose Ockeghem did it with the Missa Prolationia, Missa Prolationis, or whatever it's called, where he has a score and no parts, so they've got four different time signatures, four different clefs, but it's only two lines, which is an extraordinary thing. Anyway, I digress completely. So it's a really interesting bit, and also sort of very, you know, sort of like a Disney thing, really, or a sort of Bugs Bunny cartoon or something like that. It's absolutely like a Scott Bradley, basically. Really, really extraordinary. and the voicing is just magnificent. So we'll come across that in a minute. But let's just sort of deal with just page one. As you can see, there's just so much in here. And, you know, it's almost bewildering to start off to sort of think, okay, well, let's just take it as it comes. You know, what's melody, what's not, what's accompaniment, and try and break it down. So one of the things in here is his prolific use of, you know, various sorts of subsets of Hungarian minor. That's basically what it sort of is. So sort of the abbreviation of Hung minor, but that's what it means. So that's what it is. And it's actually mode four of a double harmonic scale as well. Which would be this, which is very much a sound of Williams in a lot of his work, and we've got all sorts of alpha chords, which is very similar to what Jaws was, so sort of earmarking here where that is. it's really, really interesting, and how it sort of basically starts off in sort of an A-flat territory, and then goes into a sort of D territory, and it sort of continues slightly in that, and then does this sort of oscillation between B and A-flat, or B and G-sharp, whatever you like to call it, and keeps going, and it's all sort of very octatonic at that point, and then eventually it looks as though it's about to go to C major, but doesn't, go somewhere else, and then keeps going towards eventually dominant onto B flat, which is just crazy. So the tonal design of it is just all over the place, really. And it's just so heavily, thoroughly, thickly orchestrated. So I think this is actually in the wrong place. I've just realised that here. Anyway, but let's not worry about it too much to begin with. So we've got, main tune, which is just sort of climbing up with a target note of A. But what's happening before that? So we've got sort of very specific chords. So the first one is E major chord with a flat six, so a very familiar chord to anybody who's been following the Phantom Menace and all my Star Wars things. So it's called 419B, a sort of pitch set. It's a major chord with a flat six. Just realised that I'm now editing everything. So that is a chord that derives both from hexatonic 620, which is a scale which goes minor second, then minor third, then minor second, then minor third, then minor second, like that. Or 6Z19B, which is slightly different, which is actually derived from this one, often missing out that fourth note. But you can get it easily by having two minor chords a semitone apart. So that's where it's from. and then we got another version of that chord, but transposed differently, where you've got this sort of chord here. So you've got an augmented chord with a major seventh, and that's another version of 419 as well. And major sevenths are very important to Williams. He uses them all the time, and even inverted as well. They're just something that he just seems to have, that sort of semitonal design, especially when he wants to sound sort of modern, atonal, that sort of thing. So interestingly enough here, we've got this sort of A-flat, well, you could also call it an A-flat augmented with an 11th as well, or another fourth, that sort of thing. Pardon me. So here in the strings, you can tell that it's actually changed chords by the second point. And so the E-flat creates a little bit of ambiguity here, because we've got E-flat, but we've also got E-natural at the same time. But because it's happening so quickly, we don't really, the ear doesn't sort of go, oh, that's a bit odd. It just sounds gnarly. But, you know, those false relations are all over the place in film music generally. And have been since the 1300s. I remember an idiotic library music company telling me that it was a wrong note when it was just a false relation. I never worked for them ever again, thank God. Then we go from this chord straight into a C minor with a major ninth. Like that. So it's sort of really an extension of this A flat chord, just sort of going up another third, and it seems to sort of, you know, the rise here creates that sort of tension as well, especially because you've also got an ascending line with the strings. Then it comes back down again onto a sort of A flat minor with an augmented octave on it. It's a ridiculous chord, isn't it? Because of A natural and all of that sort of stuff going on, which is really weird. Sorry, that's all bass clef, actually. Really sort of, you know, those tertiary relationships are all over the place in film music generally. Think of Harry Potter and you'll be there. So, you know, going from an E to a C, that sort of thing, third relations, A flat as well, becomes a sort of G sharp to B, that sort of thing as well. So all sorts of things going on. And then it basically goes on to G minor here, but also with a major. So we've got like that. So it's a really interesting one. And that really gives rise to that sort of major minor feel is, in fact, a 417, which is an alpha chord. So anybody who is interested Mark Richards has done a wonderful course about alpha chords and things like that in action music, and this is an extremely good example, and I think actually one of the examples he gives as well. So you can see that sort of slightly Jaws-esque sort of bite at this point. And also, interestingly enough, both of those chords are 6Z19 again. So it all comes back to that sort of Hungarian minor. Remember, 6Z19B is a subset of Hungarian minor. That's where he's getting it from. That's where it comes from. Then we've got little bits of sort of filigree as well. It's just chromatic at this point. And then these scaling notes bear little relation. These ones, like that. It sounds like a sort of F minor, but it's not in F minor because it ends on a D. But as I've said here, it's just not very clear, is it? Let's just do that, I think. These scaling notes bear little relation to G major or minor or D major or minor. In counterpoint theory, though, at least one harmonic note per harmonic beat means that theoretically it should still work, which it does, of course. Then we got D major minor, D flat major minor, B flat major minor. So all of those are alpha chords, which is really wonderful. I'm just doing it with different octaves. Like that. And then we've got this 3-3 chord. So remember I said about the major seventh. This is a really good example of how he uses that, because that 3-3 chord, those three notes, is part of an alpha chord, because you've got a minor third and a major third, and then it's just inverted. Now, what that means is that it's also akin to, it's part of a subset of Hungarian minor, also 6Z19B, also 620, and also octatonic as well. So it means it's a really good little chord to have as a segue. So all of these alpha chords, which could be part of, a Hungarian minor, are also part of an octatonic, which means that when you get to the octatonic scale, which is what it is here, so octatonic T1, in other words, transposed up by one semitone, it starts on a C sharp. Here we go. Like that. It absolutely works. And it makes perfect sense as well. What doesn't make perfect sense is when you have all of these sort of major minor things, and it sort of gets really complicated because everything's planing, everything's transposed. But you kind of see the design. You know, we're seeing it here. So we've got that. Then we've got some more planing, a little link passage. Like that, which then links on to this. So it's interesting. So in a sense, this bit here just foreshadows this bit here, which is really, really intriguing. And the first bit is just setting all of that up in terms of sort of tonality. So we're Hungarian minor, basically. We're then introducing some alpha chords. We're then octatonic. It's just the way it's done is absolutely masterful. So when you put it together, you know, let's just listen to the Sibelius version. Like that. It's just that. I mean, it's one bar, one page rather, 10 bars, and there's just so much in there that's just crazily complicated. Absolutely unbelievably complicated. Then we've got all of these little 3-3 chords. So we'll find them in the wind at this point. Like that. Then we've got a sort of weird augmented seventh chord. That's a nice one. Sort of B flat 7 with a sharp 5. You can see how it relates quite nicely to what's been going on as well. So I've mentioned 3-3 before, so that's why I've sort of put it there. It's a classic John Williams device. and I've also mentioned Mark Richards as well, because he is truly fantastic. Then we've got a sudden harmonic change. And we've also got a long short, a short long, which is another sort of device of Williams where he just has a short note followed by a long note. Simple as that. They're often not necessarily sixths. They're often like that, the sort of diminished fifth or augmented fourth type of interval. So then we're getting into a sort of a half diminished. Then we've got a little 0-1-3-4, which is part of an octatonic. But now he's just sort of crunching it a little bit and sort of squeezing the intervals. Then we got another interesting sort of, again, major seventh, this time with a different note. So all of those sort of different sort of combinations. In other words, you span a seventh, and virtually any other note will work. Literally every other note. I think there's one that didn't quite. Yeah, so an E flat doesn't really work. Everything else does. Really weird, isn't it? So another octatonically derived chord, which I can't spell, of course. pardon me for coughing, but I'm still not very well. So then we've got a little bit of ba-ba-da-ba, which is sort of, it's kind of going to come in later. It's another bit of foreshadowing. So then we've got a sort of Willie Scott reference at this point, which is from the theme. It's a bit tenuous. I'm not quite sure whether it really is related, but I like to think that it is. And then we've got this extraordinary chord. So sort of B with a major seventh, and a sort of joke B major. Because if you think about how that works, going back into a tonic here, it's a bit strange. So let's just take it from the beginning. We'll try and get to it. So it's about sort of bar vintage. And it's this sort of raucous, like that, that raucous theme. And then it goes into our 418 pitch set, which is basically a subset of octatonic and Hungarian minor. So it's unusual. It's not quite Phantom Menace territory, but it does go on quite a long time, like this. It's pretty relentless, isn't it? But because you have all of these little interjections, it doesn't seem quite as relentless. This time we've got things on the beat as well, which is, again, usual. Usually Williams will have it off the beat, but here we go. And then we got those sort of bits as well. So they're all 419 chords. So remember, way back here, they're all of these sorts of chords. So augmented chord with a major seventh and then scrunched. And also, interestingly enough, all from B Hungarian minor. So we could perhaps say that really it is a B Hungarian minor, but we've also got sort of like an inflected B major minor sort of thing. No, it's sort of B territory anyway. So it's interesting. Probably the clearest example I know of a mixed tonal centre in B, or an octatonically derived ostinato, or it could be, is counterpointed against a parallel Hungarian minor mode. So we've got, is what I mean there, because it's derived from octatonic T1. So you can see all of those notes. And on the same starting pitch, that's what I mean by parallel, we've also got the Hungarian minor. It's very, very similar indeed. And it's an interesting example of it, where you've got two different sorts of scalic forms, but at the same time, people talk about polymodal chromaticism. This is a good example of it, but not using you know, modes like the Lydian mode or Phrygian mode. It's just these are two different scalic types. They could still be called modes, of course, but they're just two ones which are not sort of church modes, if you see what I mean, or jazz modes. So here we go. Although they are using jazz, by the way, of course. Maybe they are jazz modes too. I'm not a jazzer, as you can tell. So then we've got our little theme again, which is now extended with an extra sort of little tag at the end. And that is a very small way in which John Williams takes an idea and then he takes it for a line. You know, so the first time is just this bit. And the second time it does this. Like that. And it just keeps going. And he might use that. And he does, in fact. And diminishes it. Like that. It's the sort of the next logical conclusion. And then we've got a sort of supporting descending movement. Again, a sort of raucous idea. So interesting enough, it changes key at this point. Or chord, rather. To a sort of D half diminished against C. Then we've got little cheeky. Little 3-3. Which is just intensifying that D half diminished with a full diminished chord. Again, it's that sort of jaws idea that we had before, which was foreshadowed just here. There we go. So it keeps making a little bit of a reappearance, unsurprisingly. Then it ends on a full sort of, you know, D half diminished seventh with a C, but with an added B as well in that chord. Crazy, sort of all sorts of things going on. Then we got another alpha chord at this point, so an A flat major minor chord, but with C in the bass. Note that a lot of these don't have root position on them. They're sort of other things. Like that. And we're still in B Hungarian minor, actually, oddly, because it's sort of oscillating downwards. Pardon me. And then we then get another little reiteration of theme. At this point here, we got C major, seventh with a G, which is quite unusual. Just that sort of bit of happiness, but it's counterbalanced against. Like that, where we got nice E naturals and E flats as well. That sort of mixed major minor flavour as well. We've got another bit of 3-3 going on. Like there. That sort of idea. Another extremely common device. Here we get a short long. Ba-ba-ba. Offbeats as well. Angular, jagged, that sort of thing. That's the whole point of doing an action cue. Lots of mixed metrical times as well. Notice it never really changes tempo. There are lots of composers who change tempo to coincide with things. And what Williams is able to do, I think, very effectively, is to not bother changing the tempo, but just change the metric space, which you can do when everything's jagged and angular. You can't really do it if it's all sort of, you know, four beats to a bar. It just doesn't work that way. So it's an interesting way of doing it. And there are, you know, different ways of scoring to picture. This is just one of them. The other one is to change nuance and beat and have a bit more flexibility. And neither is better than the other. They're just different approaches. So another little bit of, 3-3 at this point. Remember, as I said, that 3-3 can add any other note. And it will still sound fine. It will have the same purpose and function. We got some nice, interesting sort of bits here. C, add, flat 6, major, minor, 9th. Really ridiculous. So it's like a C major and then G sharp diminished. Yeah. really crazy. So then we've got some other crazy little bits here, little jagged. Nice little sequence. And they're all sort of little chords which are akin to all of our little Hungarian minor things going on. So another typical sort of John Williams-esque gnarly harmony at this point. So so that's our A minor with a flat six, but with a completely wrong bass. Then he's got a B minor with a sharp four, with another wrong bass, C diminished with an add two, then E flat with a flat six, with another wrong bass, G minor with a major seventh. I don't know why I put B flat there, because it's an F sharp. Sometimes I make some strange decisions. Anyway, there we go. And then we got A flat with a flat six, with another wrong bass, C sharp, half diminished, and then all 419 chords. But let's look at how many 419 chords there are. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 in the space of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 beats. So 7 out of 11 are that specific type of scrunchy chord, major chord with a flat six. That's interesting. So in order to give it some sort of continuity, maybe he likes to have the same sort of chord shape. Which makes it really interesting. Now we get onto the dance bit. And I think what I'm going to do is actually break that down into a separate video, because there's so much in this that I think it would be wise to carry on, because it's just so much to absorb. So yeah, I think I'll do that in the next video. So that's all for now, folks. See you later.